Hello everybody, and welcome back, me again. First of all, thank you. Thank you very much to all the guys who commented on my last video, with obviously issues with our Misfire on Cylinder 2. Had a lot of great suggestions on there. A couple of them I hadn't thought of before, a lot of them I have, but that's, you know, to be expected. But it's very nice that people have taken time out of their day to even just have a think about a problem. And try and help. So, you know, that's one of the better things about communities such as YouTube, getting people to, you know, chip in and help and leave, you know, helpful comments on videos. There's a lot of hate in the world nowadays, right? People are always leaving comments. It's so easy to be a keyboard warrior. So it's really nice to have people actually going, you know what, try this, and, you know, best of luck, and, you know, let me know how it turns out. You know, it's cool. So I appreciate that. So we're back today with a green box on the boot, Lucas box. It can only mean one thing. It is new distributor day. As you can see, nice shiny new Lucas distributor. Apart from the cap, which is now on the floor, probably with a chip in it. Nah, it's all good. Got a brand new cap anyway. Brand new rotor, points, condenser, points gaps already set. Fresh cam lobe, no play in it. Oh, it's lovely. Nice shiny vacuum pump. Terrible about things you get excited about as you get older, right? I remember being a kid, being dragged around the hardware store with your dad, and you were always like, I'm never gonna get excited about going to the hardware store. And then one day you suddenly become an adult and you're like, So, all we've got to do now, stick that in there and see if this is the cause of our problems. If not, someone did make a very good suggestion as to what it could be. I can't remember the name off the top of my head. I'll have a look in a minute, or I'll put it on screen now, who mentioned it could be a vacuum leak where I've put my servo assist brake on, because the inlet barb is right on the inlet manifold near to cylinder 2, so it could actually well be that. I don't think it is, because, you know, I've done it all up nice and tight, but, you know, I will have a look. But that was obviously after I ordered this. So this is here now. Let's stick this on. Fingers crossed, is the distributor, and we've got a happy car. God, I hope it is. Still missing on two. Good news, bad news scenario. Good news is I've got a brand new distributor. The bad news is that wasn't it. So, next thing to try is a comment by Ed Bells. So that's you, thank you very much for commenting. I would block off the vacuum line to your brake booster. If you have a leak, it would affect cylinder 2 more than the other. Okay, so that's something I've not really thought of. It's pulling a vacuum somewhere in there. It's obviously going to spoil the air-fuel mixture, and that's going to do it. So, let's go and have a quick look at that. So here we have our brake servo, because obviously the brakes in these cars are crap. This is the vacuum line, so obviously the brake servo pulls a vacuum from the inlet manifold. So this is our vacuum line, and as you can see, it goes into the stud here, which is obviously in line with the carb that feeds cylinder 1 and 2. So what I'm going to do is, you can see there, if I zoom you in, that the stud isn't perfectly flush with the manifold bolt. Now you might look at that and think, ah, dickhead, there you go, that's your problem immediately. But that is in tight, and I mean tight, tight, tight. So I'm going to take both of those off, put them in the vise, and see if we can test this for an air leak. The new distributor was only 60 quid, so it's not the end of the world.
At least you've future-proofed that part. I got lots of spare parts now. I got spare HT leads, plugs, points, condensers, two distributor caps. So I've got a nice box of spares to put in the boot, which, you know, with classic cars, that's not a bad thing, right? Having a spares box in the boot. Electronic fuel pump. So bit pissed that it's not the distributor. I was hoping that will be a drop it in, it's fixed sort of scenario, but clearly it's not. So what can you do? Nothing I can do but carry on trying to fix it. There's obviously a reason there somewhere why I don't want to run. So let's pull that vacuum stud out and we'll have a look on the bench and see if we can find a leak around that.
Okay, so this is our manifold takeoff stud. So I've used the original manifold blanking bolt, which has then been drilled out and tapped to accept this stud. Now, again, whilst it doesn't sit flush with the bolt, if I put this up to my mouth and cover it over, you can't see me do it, but that is airtight, as hard as I can blow. And whilst I know blowing isn't a particularly clinical test, you know, the vacuum that the manifold pulls isn't any greater than the power that I can blow, if that makes sense. So it isn't a vacuum leak between here and the bolt. So the next thing to do will be to check to see if I can seal that inlet manifold off and run it again with nothing in there at all. So let's see if I've got a bolt this same size that I can just put in the manifold for the time being.
Okay, just tried running it with my thumb over the hole in the inlet manifold. Didn't seem to make any difference. I know putting your thumb over a hole isn't exactly a clinical test. I can't find a bolt the same size as that to go in it, nor would I want to stuff something in it that could get sucked in. So I managed to sort of jiggle my around and put my thumb on it. Didn't seem to make any difference. So what I have just quickly done is I've put an O-ring on the bottom of the thread there, just so now when that's bowled up nice and tight, obviously if there was any vacuum leak around there, that will take care of it. There's no vacuum leak here between the two, between the two sections, that gap, no vacuum leak there. I've checked the hose for splits, nothing there. If I suck on the hose nice and tight, you know, going to the brake servo, no loss of vacuum there at all. I know sometimes you can split hoses when you put Jubilee clips on. No split in the hose at all. So it might be me imagining it, but when the engine's running and I put my head down next to the carbs, it sounds like I can hear vacuum, but of course you're going to hear vacuum because there's air going through the carbs. I'm getting to the paranoid stage now. So I'll put this back on with the O-ring. I'll try again, see what happens. What's got two thumbs and four cylinders? This guy. I think we cracked it. Oh, and by the way, I'm a dick. Sounds like four cylinders to me, right? Okay, it's still a little bit, you can hear it's a little bit patchy. Got the occasional misfire, which is just down to tuning, fine-tuning the timing and the mixture. Let me just turn it off. I know. And I know what you're going to say. You're going to say, you're a dick. And I'm going to agree with you. So, let's back this up. New distributor fitted, same thing, missing on two. Possible vacuum leak around the manifold stud where we've pulled the brake servo from. Possible vacuum leak around there. No. So it sort of got me thinking. I started looking at the carbs, and on the top of each of the fuel pots, there's two inlets on mine. One is the main inlet, and one, I thought, was a fuel return or a fuel balancer. So previously I had nothing on that second port. I just had fuel going in one side, coming out of that and going across to the other side. The other two ports on the top of the fuel pots were not in use. I left them as breathers. I thought that's fine. I noticed then when I started to put my finger over them, the engine started to change. It started to run pretty rough. But in the midst of running rough, it also started to fire properly. And I thought, should I have a piece of line between those two fuels, between the two ports on the fuel pot? Turns out no. I put a piece of line between the two and ran it up, and it basically just died and flooded. I had fuel dripping out of the carb where the air filter goes on. So I sort of did a quick bit of Googling, and it was like, no, leave those open, they're breathers. Obviously, as the fuel starts to get consumed, you need obviously air to replace it, otherwise it creates a vacuum in there and it's going to suck lots of fuel in. And the only place it can get out is obviously around the needle, and it's going to pour out, which it did. If I show you what I'm talking about. So this is fuel pot number one. You can see my fuel line, which you can see under there, comes up there into a little filter, goes into a T-piece. One side of that T-piece goes to this carb, and the other one goes to that carb. Obviously both have their own float bowls in, which close them off. On the back of this one, you can see there's an extra fuel pot there. And there's also an extra fuel port on the back of that one there. So whilst I was wrong in linking the two together, there was me thinking maybe they need to be capped off, you know, put my thumb over it, and the engine started to change, and I thought, For a moment there, it was firing on two cylinders, then it coughed and died. Pulled the vacuum hose off completely, and I thought, just have a look at the needles on the carbs. So, pulled the pots off, took them to one side, had a look at the needles. Needles were all moving freely, going up and down. Didn't look damaged in any way. Okay, well, it's not that then. And when I went back and looked into the carbs, obviously with the pots off the top, you can look straight down, you can see the jet. I noticed on the left-hand carb, the one that feeds cylinders 3 and 4, the jet was much further down than it was on 1 and 2. You can see where this is going already. The one on the left-hand side was 13 flats down from the bridge. The one on the right was only 6 flats down from the bridge. And whilst I've been playing with the mixture in the past, I've recently put reconditioned carbs on, and I haven't really played with the mixture since then. So I bolted them on, blah blah blah, and where we are now with one of the cylinders missing. So the long and short of it is, it was way too lean on the right hand carb, which feeds cylinders 1 and 2. There was 13 flats down on this side, but only 6 flats down on the other side. So basically it was a fueling issue. There was not enough fuel coming up through the jet to make it fire. Because I did notice before, and even now it's going around in my head, I'm suddenly thinking about it, when I would start the car with a choke on, it would run okay. Or should I say, it always ran okay for the first 30 seconds or so of starting the engine, and then it would peter off and only run on 3 cylinders. Obviously with the choke open, it pulls the jet down, allows more fuel to go past the needle, and then as I'm closing the choke, coming around to the front, playing with the throttle to see if I can hear it, it's running on 4 cylinders for a minute, I'm thinking, yay! And then of course, the amount of fuel in that side is being cut down when you close the choke, close the jets, goes back to running on 3 cylinders again. So I'm happy, you know, I'm happy I found the problem, that's good news. I still need to play, like I say, I need to play with the timing and the mixture a little bit, so I probably will invest in one of those colour tune things, because I'm not sure I can do it by ear. They are now both 12 flats down from the bridge, and that seems to be running okay, but we have still got a slight splashy misfire, so next job will be to play with the mixture and just fine tune that slight adjustment in the dizzy cap. So the good news is, I've got a brand new distributor, new HT leads, new plugs, new coil, new spark plugs, new leads, I've got a new everything, new rotor cap, new rotor arm. I've got the works. I've even got a little memorandum there on my alternator, just to remind me of the firing order if I ever come to pull it off again. And various other things. I've also noticed that I've used almost £20 worth of petrol in trying to tune this car over the last few weeks. It's been an absolute ball ache. I've just been here idling, getting hot. It's been a nightmare. And all the time I've been thinking, bad cam.
you know, something terminal, bah, the camshaft's worn, maybe the valves aren't opening as much as they should, maybe it's compression, maybe the rings are gone, you know, all the bad thoughts you have when you just can't figure out why something should be working. So the good news is it's got all new components. The bad news is obviously I've paid for it, but you know, whatever, there we go, that's part of owning classic cars. So I've got lots of spares now, that's good. So let's do one final test. Let's fire it up right now and make sure it is indeed running on all four cylinders and that wasn't some kind of crazy fluke. So here we go. Right, no choke, she's nice and warm, so no choke. Currently idling at 700 to 800 RPM. Again, you can hear there's still a slight splashy misfire to it. I think that's just a bit lean on one side. The acid test, of course, is pulling the throttle and hearing whether it's smooth or it's lumpy. That is smooth. Obviously, you still need to play with the timing, with the mixture a little bit, but that is smooth. You can hear that's firing on all four cylinders. Let's turn it off. Is there a lesson to be learned from this? Probably. The whole time, you know, both myself and two other mechanics, you know, I'm not going to blame them in any way, shape or form. They're only coming over and looking over my work. They haven't built this. They wouldn't have known about the mixture on the carbs, but we were all in the mindset, well, mixture wouldn't give you something like a complete misfire. It might run a bit lean or whatever, but why would it always manifest itself in cylinder two? And again, that's still a bit weird, really. Why did that fuel shortage only manifest itself in cylinder two? Why did it not ever carry across to cylinder one? Who knows? Who cares, really? We found the problem. But it's a bit of a weird one. So, is there a lesson to be learned from all this? Probably. Check the simple stuff first before you go out buying new components and assuming something terminal was wrong with your car. So make sure that your timing and your mixture is all good. Obviously check the simple stuff like your plugs and your leads and all that. Reasonably simple things to test. But yeah, like I said, I'm a dick. I should have checked that first of all. I should have, you know... The thing with obviously with mixture on a car is when you're looking at the jets in from the front, it's very hard to see how high they are. They're a hex bolt, which means it has six flats on it. So it was six out, which meant it was only one turn out. So one turn of that mixture on the jet equals everything we've seen here today. So if you're having problems with misfiring, maybe you found your way here by some freak of chance to my tiny video channel, and you're having the same issue as me, I'll put some tags on this one, you know, misfire one cylinder, so in the hope that someone, it might help someone else, if they might be throwing money at it like me and going, you know what, bollocks to it, I can't be asked with it, I'll sell it off. And it could be something simple as turning a nut one full rotation. Probably won't be, but you know, in my case, it was. So there we go. Again, why it only manifests itself in cylinder number two, I have no idea. But there we go. It appears to be cured. So, the next video will be me, possibly the wife, in this car. The car that I've grown to love and hate in equal measure. It's consumed a year of my life getting it from the rusted hulk it was to where it is now, and again, it still needs a little bit of fine tuning, but we are at least now most of the way there and we know the issues. I have got a blowing exhaust as well. I noticed up at the top I need to get some new exhaust. One of the exhaust studs has snapped, as they do, so I need to drill that out or tap it out and put a new stud in that. But you know, that's not going to stop me driving it. Having a slightly puffy exhaust, that's not going to stop me. And I need to tidy up a little bit inside. And finally put the old girl's bonnet down. I mean, she's been like this forever. I want to get some of those gas struts as well for the bonnet. So if anyone knows which struts they are, what the size or even a link for them,
leave a message, let me know, because I hate having this thing propped up on this. It's an absolute, it's a death trap. You know, in the winds, if that bonnet blows that way and that bar kicks over, it comes down and Pac-Mans the shit out of you. I've had it twice now. Luckily, I'm pretty fat and a bit roughy-tufty, so it doesn't really, you know, but it, man, it hurts. Like one time I had my arm under the wheel arch like that. So that edge of that wheel arch came down and chopped me right on the arm. Yeah, not very pleasant. So I'd like to get some gas adjustable struts. And also, of course, it only ever holds on that side. So the bonnet is always tilted slightly, which isn't very good. So yeah, if you know anything about those gas struts, sorry to go off topic, but if you do, let me know. Without having to pay, you know, megabucks for them.
If it's part of a kit that's like 150 quid, I don't want to know about it. I'll go and, you know, buy a couple of tenner each and try and retrofit them. I'm not paying that sort of money for two gas struts. But if, you know, if they're affordable, let me know. I'd love to put them on. So, there we go. I'll stop rambling. I will wrap this one up. Again, like I said at the start, many thanks to all of you who have followed, commented, chipped in. I really do appreciate it because there are plenty of things there I didn't think of. I thought I'd thought of everything. So yeah, even though they weren't accurate and no one said check the mixture, but then again, I didn't think of it either, and I've been staring at this damn thing for, feels like, you know, probably a month now, coming out here tinkering, tuning, and just not getting it right. So there we go, something for us all to learn maybe. But again, thank you very much for following, I really do appreciate it as always. And let's get the old girl out in the next couple weeks. Hopefully we'll have some sunshine. Weather's not been great here at the moment, to be honest. It was warm and then it went cold again. It's only April, I know, but in the next 4 weeks or so, it'll start to get nice outside. And then hopefully we can take this damn thing out and actually drive it. That would be amazing, right? So, thank you, and I will see you all next time.